Ability to detect this thing requires that we probe very large scales. Because on small scales, you have other non-linear effects that are non-trivial to resolve. So you are better going up on very large scales where the overdensities are small, so you can use perturbation theory consistently to answer such questions. And an opportunity is coming from the intensity mapping, H1 intensity mapping, that if we use SKA1, so SKA1 is the survey that could cover about the 10,000 square degrees of the sky, using intensity mapping method, and that you can actually do that very fast. So the idea is that using intensity mapping, you have a better chance of constraining theories of gravity and primordial non-Gaussianity. So to be able to do cosmology, you know, you have to rely on endpoint function. So the important thing that most people are looking at is the two-point correlation function or the power spectrum. So people are also beginning to look deeply into the bispectrum. It's more complicated almost all effort so far is directed on the power spectrum, but the tempo is shifting to the bispectrum. So, and this part, nobody at the moment is still very high though. The tri-spectrum, the four-point correlation function. So the most important thing is that if you add the higher point function, it gives you more room to constrain cosmological parameters instead of just using the power spectrum. That's why it's also interesting to look at the higher endpoint function. But what I'll be talking about will be mostly on the two-point correlation function. If there is time, I will mention a very small thing that we have done on the bispectrum. So the idea for the power spectrum is that you have surveys that have been able to fill up this space up to the equality scales. So you have lambda alpha, weak lensing, you can actually construct the projected power spectrum for all those things. But intensity mapping is aiming to cover these scales up to the horizon scale. So these scales haven't been probed except for the few data points you get from the CMB. So that's the aim. Intensity mapping is hoping to cover this area. And we are very optimistic that if we are able to cover those areas, we can actually constrain some of the parameters, that's the primordial non-Gaussianity and theories of gravity that I mentioned. So this is a work by Zev Fonseca with a postdoc at UWC in 2015. So what it's showing is the error budget on primordial non-Gaussianity and FGR. FGR is a parameter that defined to be able to constrain theories of gravity. If FGR is 1, you are dealing with the GR. So if it differs from 1, then other theories of gravity would come in. So here, the fiducial value for the FNL is also 1. So if you're able to detect FNL different from 1, then you have an evidence that you have primordial non-Gaussianity. So in this case, you have they considered two kinds of tracers. One is, this one is the intensity mapping, and the other one is the galaxy number count, such as the Euclid Light Survey. So what is showing that if you consider these things independently, the best you can do when you cover up to the 30,000 square degrees of the sky, as this dot line, you can go down to about less than 1, reduce the error to around 1. But if you cover, say, the 10,000 square degrees of the sky, so the dashed line is about 10,000 square degrees of the sky, then this is the total sky, then 2/3 of the sky. So this is just what you can get. But for you to be able to constrain primordial non-Gaussianity, or to do better than the CMB, you need to go down you need to have errors much below these levels, because PCMB has errors around 5 or so. So, but there's now a new method that they are developing, the multi-tracer method. So the idea is to combine tracers, two different tracers that are looking at the same patch of the sky. So what the advantage it offers you is to that you will be able to beat down cosmic variance. Because when you are probing structures on these very large scales, you are limited by cosmic variance. So there's less number of sources that you can see on those scales. But if you focus on using two different tracers to look at the same patch of the sky, then if you do the analysis, what this is saying is that the marginal error will reduce. You have the noise level on X axis and the marginal error here. So the dashed line is, if you are considering, so what they are probing here is the same part of the sky, about 7,500 square degrees of the sky. If you use a single tracer, the error will be much above, because it will be at the CMB level. But if you use the multi-tracer formalism, that this dark line and dark line, you will see that if you are able to reduce the noise level in your instrument, as you improve your instrument to noise level, your error goes down. So this is an advantage that the multi-tracer formalism would provide. So with multi-tracer formalism, you have a better chance of constraining the primordial non-Gaussianity and also probing the theories of gravity on very large scales. So it's on this that almost every effort is now being gathered to make sure that we understand this thing properly. So the work I'm going to talk about is based on this. So what I'm actually looking at is to look at the weak points of these arguments. So one of them is that it made an assumption that on very large scales, on those large scales, the linear approximation that they've used is valid. So it hasn't really been tested. I wanted to play around to see if there's anything I can find. So, and the other thing is that they say that the Gaussian bias, because on the way you dictate primordial non-Gaussianity from two-point correlation function is that the non-Gaussianity imprint is on the bias. That's the one you have more chances of dictating, not the one in the dark matter density field. So their bias, I will show you later, has two components, the Gaussian part and the non-Gaussian part. The non-Gaussian part has a scale dependence, and the Gaussian part is scale independent. And you need that to be scale independent to be able to pick up the scale dependent part. So that is the trick. So I'll look at these things, and I'm hoping you'll be able to understand the crazy thing I was doing. So the points, the main theoretical basis for measuring primordial non-Gaussianity is based on this one, that you think that the linear theory is enough to describe clustering on very large scales, that H1 intensity, that the H1 is a good tracer of the underlying dark matter density field. So these are very key. So if you take these two things, you have the other thing, if this is a tracer, so you have also sort of an equivalence principle. If you impose locality, you would notice that this is sort of a probe. The way I like to think about it is just like a test particle dancing around in the gravitational field of the dark matter density field. So when you do that, you see that the imprint will only have a minimum of two partial derivatives of your gravitational potential. So it can be less than this, but it can be greater, as I will tell you later. So if you take this and you do the kind of decomposition you do, you see that you would have the tidal part, that is the trace-free part that describes the tidal field, and the trace part is just your density field. I've used the Poisson equation to relate that. You also have the anti-symmetric part. So at linear order, if you impose the linear order, see that the only one that could actually affect the H1 over density is the trace part. Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. We don't understand this equation. You've got partial d I partial dj, and then equals itself, and then minus and plus the same term.
Oh.
Is
that? Sorry.
Is there a
sorry. There's a. There should be. The idea is the notation is confusing. I'm sorry. you know, you have. Let's say you have a rank two tensor. That's the idea. You can split it into the symmetric part and the anti-symmetric part. So you have the symmetric part from here to here. That should be a bracket. Then the anti-symmetric part is around here. So I've replaced partial of 5 with VI. So this should be the trace-free part of the symmetric part. Sorry. The notation is crappy, and apologize. But you can skip this part and look at this. Just take this as the trace-free part of this guy, and this is the trace, and this is the anti-symmetric part. So if you are at the linear order, because you have a H1 over density scalar, the only thing that can affect it from here is that you have to construct the scalar invariance from the symmetric trace-free part. So if you construct a scalar invariance, it will be second order in over density. So it wouldn't come in at linear order. This one will be the trace part will be the only thing that will be important. So you can actually write H1 over density as a function of the underlying dark matter density. So when you take this off, you would notice that if you have a Gaussian initial condition, you can write your over density, H1 over density as this, where V1 is just the bias parameter. There are ways to actually calculate that. But if you have, if your initial conditions are non-Gaussian, then you would have this anti-symmetric part. Sorry, you have the scale-dependent part coming in. This FNL parameter, as I showed you before, it is it's telling you the amplitude of non-Gaussianity you would expect from the early universe. So this is the theoretical basis for primordial non-Gaussianity imprinting on large-scale structure from the bias. And you see that from the scale dependence that will show up on very large scales, because this is just a H over K. It's close to the horizon scale, that's where it will pick up. So if you write down the power spectrum for the H1 brightness temperature as this, it's just the bias squared of your matter power spectrum. So you can write down the bias as this. So this is if you look at this, and I plotted this here, the part that we are most interested in is beyond the equality scale. So if you have a Gaussian initial condition, the predicted power spectrum based on the linear theory would be like this. It goes down the dashed line. But if you have, if the initial conditions are non-Gaussian, you will start to see an upturn here, close to the horizon scale. It is this signature that you hope to extract. If depending on how the upturn looks like, you'll be able to constrain the FNL. And if you plot the bias, what I defined in the earlier slide, you will see that if your FNL is zero, that you have just pure Gaussian initial condition, you will have a straight line like this, just the red straight line. There's no scale dependence. But if you have small imprint of non-Gaussianity, say FNL of 0.2, you will get the blue curve here. So when you do the fit, depending on the value of your FNL, one of these. So the other thing, as I said, is there any other, because ability to detect this thing is dependent on scale dependence. Is there any other sorts of scale dependence that will make this less reliable? So that's what I tried here, because the other thing I consider is if the linear theory is valid, at least you have to establish that the remainder time here is zero in those scales. So this will be the crude motivation what I tried first was to calculate to see that whether the remainder time that you get here is almost vanishing in those scales. So if you go beyond that and realize the linearity as you would have this. Just to show you where the nonlinear imprint would come in. So at linear order, you have the bias like this. You can do a standard mode decomposition. So at linear order, you can split a small scale mode and the large scale mode. So you can properly decompose them. But if you go beyond the linear order, you will notice that you have a coupling term here, that you lose that ability to split them properly. So it's this term that once you add the nonlinear bias term, you will get a term that couples the short scale, the small scale mode and the large scale mode. So if you go beyond, if you add the B3 bias, that's when this is the power 3, you will also get other terms that couple both modes. So that's what I'm trying to calculate. So if you calculate the power spectrum, including the nonlinear corrections up to one group, this is what you will get. At linear order, it will look like this. And B22, that's the 2 second order terms, will give you this. You will notice that you have the B2 bias coming in here. Then the P13 is when you have a correlation between the linear bias and the third order. That's linear overdensity and the third order overdensity. So you will get this. The most important thing to look at is the imprint of the nonlinear terms. The nonlinear bias in the last time here and the last time here. So when you plot the power spectrum, this is what you get. This is still in real space, no GR correction coming in yet. So this is our power spectrum at different ratios, starting from ratio of 0.5. So what it's really saying is that in addition to what is well known, that nonlinear effect will affect clustering on small scale here, the power spectrum also differ on large scales. So the dashed line is the linear power spectrum, while the thick line is the total power spectrum with the nonlinear corrections. So you get the difference between the two on small scales and also on large scales. So if what I have here is just the fractional difference, the correction here on horizon scale is about 10% at the ratio of 0.5. If you go to higher ratios, nonlinear effects are not supposed to be that bad, so it goes down dramatically. So that's the key point of Palmer. You notice a nonlinear imprint also on large scales. And if you try to construct an effective linear theory on large scales, starting from what I showed you here, you can actually rewrite the linear power spectrum. It's being corrected here. So the linear power spectrum will look like this. You wouldn't have just the B1 bias parameter. You will have all the nonlinear bias parameter correcting your power spectrum on that scale. Then you have also this term, which depends on the B2 bias parameter, still describing the coupling between the short scale mode and large scale mode. So when you define the effective bias using the standard definition that I showed before, this is what you will get. You will notice that because you have the power spectrum here dividing this term, you would immediately have a scale dependence here. So there will be additional scale dependence to your effective bias due to this term here. So these ones here are scale independent. It's possible to redefine this term. We still retain the scale dependence and the scale independence and the Gaussian bias. But this guy is scale dependent. And so when you plot the effective bias based on this definition here, this is what you will get. So on the x-axis is just the scale, and you have effective bias parameter here. And starting from the redshift of 0.5, you would notice you begin to see the scale dependent signature. If the Gaussian bias is strictly scale independent, you wouldn't see this. So this is a source of scale dependence in your Gaussian bias. So the next thing I did was to, if I implement non-Gaussianity, that is if I change to the non-Gaussian initial condition, and now see whether there's a degeneracy between the scale dependence in the Gaussian bias and the scale dependence on the non-Gaussian part of the bias. I don't know if that makes sense. So the point is that if you're looking at the redshift of 0.5, we wouldn't really see the bias because of the tracer we're looking at, the H1. At low redshift below 1, the bias is less than 1. So you have these things going on. But below the redshift of 1, the bias is greater than 1. So you begin to sort of, you have to be careful because for FNL of 0.1, at this scale, it would be difficult to actually distinguish between, unless you understand exactly what this type of scale dependence you have in the Gaussian bias. So you subtract it and still see the other signature. So it's at the redshift of 1.5 or 0.2 that you can, as the place that you need to exercise caution. So that's one thing that I looked at. The other thing is, would you get rid of the scale dependence if you do cross correlation with another tracer, like what you do in the multi-tracer case? So when you do the multi-tracer kind of thing, you still have the scale dependence because in the multi-tracer, that's ineffective due to the nonlinear bias. Second order bias parameter will still be there. So you still have this term here. So the scale dependence will still be there in the multi-tracer case. But it would go if you do a cross-correlation between H1 over density and the matter over density, because there's no bias in the matter, and you do the cross correlation. So your effective bias will just be a rewriting or a renormalization of your linear bias parameter. So there's no, it will still be consistent, it's just a rewriting of your linear bias parameter. But when you do a cross correlation between H1 and matter density field, not with any other tracer. So that's the point. So the other thing I think, if there's any question at this point, thank you. So the next thing is, I've actually talked about the basic thing that we did. The other thing is that if you now want to do things properly, because observation takes place on the path light cone, so you have to project all these things on the past light cone. And in that case, you would see that there would be other terms that would come into play. For example, the Doppler term. So if you do the redshift space distortion map, you map your position from the real space to redshift space. You get a correction to your position due to the perceptions and the redshift. So you can write them down in the plane parallel approximation. And these are the two key terms, the Doppler term and the gravitational redshift term. So when you implement this, you would have to derive, you would have to calculate the Jacobian that maps the from real space to redshift space. You will notice that there will be another decoupling term that will come in. So you have your Jacobian at linear order, it will be given by this. So at nonlinear order, if you go beyond linear order and you do the mode decomposition, you get another mode coupling term. So you calculate the brightness temperature you get this. You have the standard GR corrections, then you have the nonlinear Reshift space time. So these terms, these are the source of additional source of scale dependence, because we are doing it in Reshift space, and you have expanded the equation to second order, you get the multiplier. So you can also go to third order, and there will be other lengths in correction, but you're not taking that into account. So when you construct your power spectrum, I've only plotted here the monopole of H1 power spectrum, the Reshift space. So the signatures are still there. The difference is that in Reshift space, you have the gravitational Reshift term, which goes like, which has the same scale dependence as your primordial, that's imprint of primordial non-Gaussianity in your bias. So it goes like a to power minus 2. So it also hits on that scale. So that's why you have this curve going on. When you do that, you see that, but there will still be corrections on this curve until those are gravitational pressure and fairly big. This is the correction we get is around 0.5. So this is what everyone expects is on small scale nonlinear effect is very important. So the point I'm making is that the additional decoupling between the large scale mode and the small scale mode modify your power spectrum on large scales. And you can, this is just a table showing the corrections you get at different important scales, the equality scale and the horizon scale. The most important thing here is when you have the transverse power spectrum, but I really don't know how if it's possible to actually do that. Because for the linear, at the linear level, the when you compute the transverse power spectrum, the gravitational redshift correction is the contribution is negative. So when you construct the power spectrum, it goes to zero at a certain point. Because when you're the orthogonal component, that's, I need to explain this well. The orthogonal, that is the transverse power spectrum, the Doppler term and the standard Kaiser term do not contribute because they only depend on the line of sight. So if you are looking at the transverse component, those terms are zero. So you have only the gravitational redshift correction and your normal density term contributing. The gravitational redshift correction is negative. So there's a point close to the horizon scale where it goes to zero. So when you have nonlinear term actually dominates at that point. So that's why you have this. And it can construct the effective H1 power spectrum on very large scales, because you have additional correction. So if you had used just the linear theory, you would get the first line. But to the non-linear term that I'm talking about, you would add this line with the second and the third line. And you can also calculate the effective bias, as I mentioned before. But I didn't calculate that because of there are other issues that yet to actually understand properly. There will be sort of an averaging problem, kind of. Because if you construct the effective bias here, you need to average over all sky to remove this scale dependence. And you have to match that the bias, effective bias you get here is proportional to the one you get in Reshift space. So if one person who has done this before said that both of them did not match. So you have a kind of an averaging problem, but I haven't really done that problem to make a similar thing. So I think I would conclude by showing you this, that on very large scales, if you are looking at dark matter density field, that probing initial conditions on very large scales, that the linear theory is valid. But if you are looking at the initial condition, to through the dark matter density theorem, that's the bias that we talked about, that you need to include nonlinear corrections. So, and if you are doing the observation in relative space, that your effective theory on large scales would also include some nonlinear inference due to mode coupling. So this is the summary of the claim that I'm making. So the conclusion is that there are three possible sources of scale dependence that we need to understand properly. One is the primordial non-Gaussianity, which is now well known. Two is the nonlinear local bias parameter, the one that I discussed time coming. Then the third one is if you add higher derivative corrections to what I said to your geodesic deviation equation, because the one you used to derive that the partial derivative of phi is just the linear approximation of your geodesic deviation equation. So if you go beyond the linear order consistently, there will be other derivatives of your Ricci tensor that will come in. And that will introduce additional scale dependence in your bias. So that's where I will stop. There's time out of that. Yeah.
Do you have a physical intuition or explanation of why the mode coupling between the short modes and the long modes influences the power spectrum mostly on very large scales and not on intermediate scales?
I don't have a good physical intuition of why that happens. Follow mathematical consistency, but I see that. But I can't exactly tell you that this is how where it's coming from. So people have made similar claims as saying that it's just due to uncertainties on small scale. They try to relate it to noise, that is noise. That is not really important. But the point is that if you make that claim that it's just noise, the term that actually causes that is this. And it depends on cosmology. So if it is noise, you have a kind of noise that will be correlated with other cosmological parameters. So it's not enough to just throw it away that you claim that it's noise, because it depends on cosmology. When you do the feature forecast, you have to take the derivatives of this with respect to cosmological parameters. While for noise, derivative with respect to cosmological parameters is just zero.
And it's also due to the fact that the notation ET affects actually the gravitational potential. So the Poisson equation, k squared, the potential is delta. So the one of the k squared comes from that, which is what actually is important here is the gravitational potential, which is delta divided by k.
So you were saying at the beginning you were going to use this to test general relativity and you had FGR. Is it possible to say what FGR corresponds to and which parts of Einstein's equations you'd be testing with these non-Gaussian biases?
Yeah. Yes. Okay. And the idea is when you project on the fast light cone, you would get a gravitational potential. And for you to calculate the gravitational potential, you need the Poisson equation to relate it to your density field. So that relationship is where GR comes in. So the relationship will differ if you change the theory of gravity. So that's the idea.
Is it testing the higher order parts of the gravitational field?
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah. Because this only keeps on very last day.
Okay. Any more questions? If not, let's thank the speaker again.